Good afternoon. My name is Adam Lupel, IPI Vice President. And it is my pleasure to welcome you to the International Peace Institute in partnership with Lincoln Center Theater for this press briefing on the play Oslo. This is indeed a true pleasure. It is a rare treat to have the opportunity to marry a discussion of the arts and international affairs at IPI. For those who do not know, there are some new partners in the room. The International Peace Institute is an independent, not-for-profit think tank dedicated to the promotion of peace, security, and sustainable development through research, convening, and strategic analysis. In addition to activities in Europe, Africa, and the Middle East, IPI holds over 100 events in this room each year, catering to the UN community and beyond. Late last year, at a farewell reception for Ban Ki-moon, which Bart and JT attended, the Secretary General, in addition to plugging the play, told his successor, who was also on hand, to take careful note that this was a room where many critical policy discussions were had. And we were all very flattered by that remark, but I have to say, I don't think we've ever had the kind of discussion that we're going to have today. With the kind of people we are privileged to have here with us. So I just want to say thank you to our partners and for our panelists for being here. We have with us J.T. Rogers, the internationally renowned playwright of the critically acclaimed Oslo, which is, I should say, now in previews at the Vivian Beaumont Theater at Lincoln Center and opening on April 13th. We have Bartlett Sher, the Tony Award-winning director of the play and resident director at Lincoln Center Theater. And of course, no stranger to this room, we have Terje Larsen, president of the International Peace Institute, who, along with his wife, Ambassador Mona Jewell, was at the center of the real life drama portrayed in the play. It is an auspicious moment to talk about peace in the Middle East and to look back on the Oslo process, to look back on how the parties came to an agreement then, when, frankly, now an agreement seems all but out of reach. In fact, the annual summit of the Arab League is meeting as we speak in Jordan with the Israeli-Palestinian conflict high on the agenda. A few years ago, IPI put out a book called The Search for Peace in the Arab-Israeli Conflict. And in the introduction, called The Crooked Course, describing the ups and downs of the peace process, Terje quoted Immanuel Kant. Out of the crooked timber of humanity, no straight thing was ever made. Well, that seems to me to be the stuff of theater right there. The play is indeed about the complex human element behind what was a truly extraordinary series of events, and we are grateful to have you all here today for this discussion. JT, Bart, and Terje will have a conversation among themselves for about 20 minutes or so, and then we will open up the floor for your questions. Bart, the floor is yours.
Hi, I'm Bart Sher. I'm the director of the show, and I'm going to try and lead us through a little bit of a chat. the first thing is, I've done many press events for Broadway shows, and this is not like any of the ones I've done in the past. That's extremely different. First of all, we've cut all the songs from Oslo, so we will perform none of the songs. I'm sorry about that. I'm going to sort of take us through the kind of, it's very strange to be dealing with the actuality of the events of Oslo in 93 and like how it is you make a play. So I'm going to start with how it came about and describe and have JT and Taya talk about how the play first came about. I have to start that conversation because it actually began because my daughter, Lucia, goes to the same school as Emma Rod Larsen. And I met Mona Jewell in front of Chapin School when they were in second grade together, and they became best friends. Through that, I got to know Taya and Mona, and talked at many events, and was concurrently doing a play with JT called Blood and Gifts. This is a play which we did at Lincoln Center 4 years ago. This play is also about politics. It was about Afghanistan in the 1980s and the Stinger missile program and how it was the most successful counterintelligence program in U.S. history, which also led to, you know, the rise of bin Laden and some other things that were that came about. During that time, we invited Taya to come and address the cast because I was trying to educate the cast about the region, and we had many guest speakers, and he came and spoke, met JT, and they got to talking about different things, and that led to this idea about Oslo. So, JT.
So we were doing my play, Blood and Gifts, and Taya came, and we'd not met, and he came and spoke and was quite fascinating, sort of talking about the issues of the double chess game, to use a phrase that you use, about diplomacy. Yes. And Bart and I were looking for another project to do together, and I was planning to write something else directly after, but we had met, and Taya came to see Blood and Gifts, and very kind about it, and the sort of authenticity, not to put words in your mouth, but of the diplomatic niceties and complexities that I put in the play. And Bart set us up to go out and have a drink and after seeing the play. So we went to PJ Clark's, which is sort of kismet, because that's where all the opening night and closing night parties at Lincoln Center shows are. We went to have a chat, and Bart had said to me, oh, you need to ask him about this Oslo thing. So that became the launching pad for me to write the play.
That's yeah, how we started. So and the other thing to think about is like, well, you know, why would you do a play like this? I mean, what is it about this particular story that makes it especially, and what is, you know, because we can talk about all the accomplishments of Oslo, but then we have to actually realize, well, people are going to pay a lot of money to actually sit in a room and like watch this story unfold. And what makes it unique as a piece of theater, and what makes the story so compelling to do it? The first entrance point for me was that you have, I've always wanted to do a piece about the Middle East, but it's impossible to talk about. Everybody's opinion is absolutely concretized in one direction or another, either in terms of the Israelis or the Palestinians or however you want to look at it. So the entrance point of a piece of theater was through the Norwegians, and that you had an objective couple who on their own made a decision to do something in a back channel. And so from a theater point of view, you have a neutral observer and a narrator, somebody you can follow it through. And then you have a lot of people doing things in secret, which is really good for theater in general, and allows there to be subtext and all kinds of other things happening. So that's sort of the premise on which we built it. Of course, then we had to kind of, we had a very complicated arrangement with Taya, which was, which I'll describe for you and then see what he thought of it, which was that we had these very close friends and we were making a play, but we wouldn't show it to them or allow them to have anything to say about it.
And they were you know, they were incredibly generous. You know, at one point he said, I remember very distinctly. He said, look, I've seen your work, I've talked, I trust you, do whatever you want to do. And that's really quite
a... So Taya had never read it and never seen any of it until he came to see it in the theater, which is...
Well, not only that, he came to see it in the theater, and then right afterwards, literally, as the lights came back up, walked on stage with the two of us to be interviewed by NPR. So we're watching him watch the play, and we talked after. I wasn't sure who was more nervous, Taya to see if his life was destroyed on stage, or me to see if he was destroyed by the fact that I destroyed his life on stage.
Yeah.
Thankfully, not.
So what was that like?
No, I mean, I think JT and Bart has done an admirable job because they have actually managed to crystallize in 3 hours what happened over 9 months. And I mean, some of the scenes in the play did not actually take place the way you are portraying it. But that's beside the point because you are not writing a book of history or making a documentary. So what I think you've done in a, what I think you've done in an admirable way. You can't hear me?
No, it's just it's okay. I think it's her phone couldn't hear her.
So. I think you managed to come to grasp with the spirit of Oslo in a very admirable way. So, and that's why I think it gives a pretty true. I think it gives a pretty true portrait. Of what actually happened, though it doesn't mirror what happened actually over those 9 months. I was. I think I'm a bit. I'm more articulate in the play than I am in real life, and I'm a bit more comical in the play than I am in real life. But I was very pleased with it, and because I think it portrays the true spirit of Oslo.
So JT, can you take us through the basic sort of structure of the play and like how you chose to sort of lead us from event to event over these 9 months?
Well, as Bart said, you know, there are tools that are more useful than others when you're making theater art as opposed to other kinds of art. And secrecy and ticking clocks and stress and deadlines and conflict are all, you know, the best working tools for a playwright. So this story had all that, plus the fantastical reality of members of the PLO and Israeli government sneaking into Norway and getting in rental cars and going to the middle of nowhere and, you know, hiding out and trying to talk about their families. I mean, sort of extraordinary, and that is a leaping off point for me. But like Bart, I too have been wanting to write something in quotation marks about the Middle East, but you can't. And so as a playwright, I'm always looking for what's the human story to set against a larger political event. And this sort of, for me, was sort of fell into my lap, or it feels like a gift in that regard. And then it became an issue of, well, if the Norwegians are our guide and our learning characters, we start with them, and then it really became a long process of figuring out where did I drop into the slipstream of this 9 month rush towards an attempt to find something, and how do you convey both the complexity but also the humanity of these people, and the sort of, without being boring, the boredom and oddness that they're experiencing being taken out of their lives and being forced. I mean, ultimately, some of this, of course, Bart and I talk about, and he's similar as a director for a writer, you finish making something and then you go, oh, that's what I was saying. And there's an element of the play that I hope is resonant now when we see it, which is, why I think, in a sense, subconsciously why I was so taken and drawn to write about it, is this is a story, certainly in my telling, of people who take the leap to sit across from their mortal enemy and push themselves to see that person's humanity, and then they themselves are changed by seeing that humanity. And that to me is both profoundly human, but also in the true sense, entertaining story, and the kind of stories that I'm interested in writing about.
Yeah, so it's, and another thing, ways to think about the story is it's an intellectual thriller. So that you actually watch with a very clear time clock from January to September of 1993, two people behind people's back decide and go through a process of how to continue to push from four people meeting to more important people meeting and upgrading until within 9 months they had a signing ceremony in the White House of the only peace agreement pretty much in the history of the region for that group and the establishment of the Palestinian Authority, a lot of things that came about. But our interest in theater is how to find this amazing story of these guys being sort of locked in a castle in Norway and being forced to talk to each other and finding their way through it with enormous stakes and enormous pressure on them as they went through. So we structure it that way, and you know, it's the kind of story which we also find audiences in New York, as sophisticated as they are, don't always know the story very well. And so in the theater part of it, we have to educate them through it, remind them of all the history, and then take them through a process. And then secretly we talk about it as a story about Republicans and Democrats, because we're trying to figure out ways that you take incredibly mortal enemies and see if they can get into a room and come to some kind of agreement. And so it's a weird kind of process of what that kind of thing is between.
And the only element I would add to it, which has been certainly important for me, and I hope it's, and you, I know, and hopefully it, those who get to see it will feel the same way, is, you know, it's become a bit of a dirty word in the theater, but you know, it's my job is to entertain you. My job is to tell a ripping story, and I think the hope for a story like, you know, understandably, because people are burnt constantly, is coming to a serious play about politics and history, is you can sort of feel the audience going, well, all right, I'm coming to eat my vegetables. But our hope and our approach is that it's the opposite of that, that the sort of humanity and surprise and joy is, I mean, there's not for nothing is the best director in the world of musicals directing the show. There's a choreography and a heft and a lightness and a joy that really serves it really well.
It's harder than a musical, but that's a different story. Ty, I want to ask specifically when there's always this, when you first got to the Middle East, what made you think you could do this?
That's a very long story, but I'll try to give a comparatively short answer. Now, frankly, when I was at university, and I was not interested in the Middle East at all, and neither was my wife, but just after she came out of the diplomatic school in Norway to take up her first posting, she had applied for Argentina, and we were preparing ourselves, learning the tango and things. And then she got Cairo, and I remember she cried when she got the news that she was being posted to Cairo, because we were going to Buenos Aires. But anyhow, I was the head of a research institute in Norway, and I took a sabbatical and went with her to Cairo. And I enjoyed thoroughly the first few months, but then I got incredibly bored, not having anything to do. So at a diplomatic reception, I saw a guy who was this spitting image of Yasser Arafat. So I asked somebody, who is that Arafat here? And it's his brother. So I befriended, Fatih was his name, Fatih Arafat. And so I befriended him, and he was a medical doctor and head of the Palestinian hospital in Cairo and the head of the Palestinian Red Crescent. So the institute I was working with in Norway specialized in statistical studies about people's living conditions. So at some stage, he suggested that we should do a living condition study in Gaza. And I basically pursued that proposal. And I then told him, neither my wife nor I have never been in Israel or in Palestine before. And it was a challenge. And so we went there together and to Tel Aviv, Jerusalem, and Gaza, the first time in Gaza. And then we saw something which made a very deep impression on us. We saw confrontations between Israeli soldiers, young soldiers, with Palestinian Jews throwing stones at them, and we saw the fear and the anxiety in the eyes of both the soldiers and the Palestinian youngsters. And we thought this is a completely meaningless conflict. I mean, we have to do something about this, which of course was a crazy and maybe megalomaniac idea. And then I had to convince my Palestinian friends that we had to make an agreement with the Israelis in order to do this living condition study, both in Gaza and in the West Bank. So I had to negotiate with the Israeli authorities to permit the study to be being done. It was a major thing. We had several hundred employees who did the interviewing in Gaza and the West Bank, and it took multiple years to do it. And so over this time, I got to know both the Palestinian leadership locally in Gaza and in the West Bank, and the Israeli leadership. And then as we moved along, which some of you might remember, there was a momentous event after the first Iraqi war, the so-called Madrid Conference, co-sponsored by the Soviet Union and the U.S., which took place in Madrid at the level of foreign ministers basically everybody from the Arab world, Israel, and the Western world, co-sponsored by the Soviet Union and the U.S. It was a very major thing. And then subsequently, there followed negotiations at the highest level in Washington. James Baker was the Secretary of State at the time. And this was in the media all the time, every day. But then I realized something when I was in Gaza and in Jerusalem, that when I spoke to the negotiators privately over lunch or dinner, they told me exactly the opposite of what they'd been telling the CNN the same morning. So I realized that they were basically, through the media, talking to their own constituencies and not to their adversaries. And I drew the very simple conclusion: we have to get him away from the media. I'm sorry. And in order to get them to talk together. And then being a sociologist, I also came to the conclusion, I taught organizational sociology at the University of Oslo for some years, and that the formatting in Washington was counterproductive. At the most, there were kind of, I think, 160 people on each side. They lived in different hotels. They just met at the negotiating table, then went straight to the cameras. So I thought we have to do it exactly the opposite way. And it was kind of a crazy thing. Some Norwegians trying to do something which the Americans and the Soviet Union was trying to do at the highest level. So trying to be short. And I also realized that the PLO and Arafat was not involved in the talks. And what I understood eventually was that Arafat and the PLO and Fatah still had such a grip on the Palestinian side that unless they were involved, they would not allow any agreement to be done, because that would be the end of the Fatah and PLO leadership. So I went to Tunis to see Yasser Arafat and, in short, convinced him to send a delegation to Oslo to see the Israelis, who we also convinced to come. And then from January 1993 until the 1st of May, it was a kind of back channel, like probably many other back channels. But then the parties themselves decided that they would actually move the real show from Washington to the secret negotiations in Oslo. So from Oslo being a sideshow in a period from January to May, and the real thing happening in Washington, the parties themselves decided to move the real thing to Oslo and make Washington, without anybody sitting there in Washington knowing, to make that into a sideshow. So this is in short what happened. And then at phenomenal speed, an agreement was made in August that year in Oslo.
And this is after years and years of nothing working. So the question becomes, when we were hearing the story, we found it thrilling and exciting. And it's where this weird intersection of theater and international relations comes about, because the chore then was, how can you make a piece of theater in which you can sort of reflect this very intense process and the speed with which it happens and the secret nature of it being behind closed doors, and allow audiences to imaginatively track into this experience and then become, in a way, co-signers or participants in a peace process themselves as they watch the thing take place. So theater can allow this event to happen and unfold in a way which makes it kind of interesting and thrilling, and which we thought would be kind of fun to invent. The problem and complexity of it is that the people in the events have to be conflated or squished together or, you know, made into a slightly different shape to give you an experience of the process, so that at the end you kind of have an understanding of what the Oslo process essentially means. So now the question becomes, how do you take this kind of experience, which is over that period of months, and squish it into the world of a play, which, by the way, we workshopped for 4 years, and the first version of the play was
four and a half
hours long, and we have way more material than we need, and we're struggling with it even at 3 hours now to get it, you know, even tighter. But there's so many things that we could write about that that's the good part of the show. So,
well, yeah, the squishing together, as you say. I mean, you obviously, as an author, you if you're basing something fictional, the joke we would talk about in rehearsal room is, this is a scrupulously researched, scrupulously accurate fiction. Because there, obviously, I took liberties and moved things around and combined characters, and someone could come see the play and say, oh, well, in real life, I had more to do with it than so-and-so. And this is all true. We've been very upfront. This is not a documentary, it's not a docudrama. It's a work of art. And the thing that I think that the theater can do, I see someone who is, by his passion and interest, deeply with one foot in policy and politics and the things that we're talking about in the world that many of you are in, and the other foot that is mine, career as the theater artist, is the thing that theater can do when we're talking about these things, is it, we are liberated from having to be right. A journalist or a politician has to have a point and has to be right. my job as an artist is not to have a point and not to be right. My job is to put people on stage in their complex humanity and say, I'm fascinated and befuddled by this. I hope you will be too. And so that was probably the starting point for trying to decide what out of this great ocean of material was I going to funnel down to a levee. And then you come to the question of, quite frankly, and this is something, you know, as a director learns over years, as a negotiator learns over years, what is most useful and most effective? How do I take the audience by the hand in a way that's most gripping and most interesting and most counterintuitive? And when you set that bar for yourself, it allows you to look at material that, say, you would learn from Terje or learn from history books or learn from films and say, that's really interesting, but that should go in the CNN documentary. This is about someone's child and their life and the surprise and their fears. That's something that should go on stage.
So we have a show which you should, you know, we're encouraging you to take a look at, which spans 3 hours, three acts, and which sort of tries to chart this whole journey from, well, actually starts in the middle and works its way back and then works forward with characters who are coming out. Now, from a directing point of view, it's, how do I describe it? It actually is harder than a musical, I have to say, for the theater press that are here. It's also interesting because our lighting designer, Don Holder, is simultaneously lighting Anastasia, a beautiful musical that's about to premiere, and our show at the same time. And I would speak for him by saying, oh, this is much harder. It takes place with 64 scenes, with a constant change of location from place to place, and is a juggernaut of events happening from one to the other. So it really blazes from beginning to end as you chart your way in time from Tel Aviv to Oslo to wherever else we go,
everywhere,
back and forth constantly in time to Washington, etc., to follow these two people as they go through all the possible obstacles and permutations to coming upon something they had no idea they could pull off and didn't even intend necessarily to pull off. So,
I mean, that's an interesting question, because in the play, in my theatrical imagination, the thing that I fixed on and fascinated me was this idea that even those who were bold and crazy enough to hatch this idea really never even in their wildest dream conceived it was going to go as far and as swiftly as it did. And there's a key moment in the play that was just two lines where the character of Mona turns to the character of Taya and says, so what do you think? And the character of Taya says, I think this is beyond what we could have possibly imagined. So for you, in the reality of it, was there a moment when you realized, even in your wildest dreams, this has gone too far, or had you in your wisdom seen all the way through from the get-go and just wanted to power on?
Now, our aim from the beginning was actually to get the parties together to create two things. One was that the parties believed each of them were in good faith in order to reach an agreement. That was number one, to create the confidence in each other. And we believe that that could not be done by institutions, but by individuals. That's why we told the parties, never more than five people in each delegation, preferably only three. They had to stay in the same house, have breakfast, dinner, lunch, and drinks, and everything together, live together, in order to create that confidence. And number two, to reach an understanding that it was possible to reach an agreement. And our ambitious plan, we thought at the time, was to produce this and then give it to the Americans so that they could use it as a platform for their negotiations in Washington. And we were taken completely by surprise when they, in May that year, came to us and said, we don't want to do it in Washington. We don't want to do it with the Americans. We want to do it with you in Oslo. So that was way beyond the ambitions we started with. And when we had the spectacular signing ceremony on the lawn of the White House in September that year, I mean, it was completely unreal to us because it was beyond anything we had ever dreamt on. But I also think this, and I think this is so well done, thanks to you two, in the play, is that, I mean, even in the darkest of hours, when things looks completely hopeless, looks completely impossible, it is possible to do the impossible. And in a way, I think it exemplifies how sometimes, it's easier to do the impossible than to do the possible. Because everybody's scrambling to do the possible, there is a competition, but nobody's trying to do the impossible. So you have the field for yourself. And of course, I mean, for some young Norwegians to kind of compete with the two superpowers at the time was a completely crazy idea. But nobody else thought about it. And one of the reasons why we managed to keep it secret was simply that it was unthinkable that anybody could do this. So, and because it was unthinkable, nobody took it seriously and bothered. So at some, when the negotiations got serious after May, I remember there was a conversation between then Foreign Minister Shimon Peres and the Norwegian Foreign Minister, Johan Jørgen Holst. And Peres told Holst in my words in my presence that after this, we don't inform the Americans about anything. So Holst turned to him, bewildered, and said, but America is our closest ally. I can't keep it secret for them. So Peres then said, well, let's make a compromise. If they ask, you can tell them. But if they don't ask, you don't inform them. And they never asked because they thought this was absolutely impossible and not serious. So so we actually conducted this without any interference from anybody and managed to keep it secret because it was beyond anybody's imagination that this could happen. And I think that gives hope. I think this is what your play, JT and Bart, is portraying in a magnificent way.
Well, one of the things that's interesting you say that, because one of the things that was a pleasure for me in the making of the play and then rehearsing with Bart is to create this sense of, this is a massive play of great suite being done in, I think, the greatest large theater in the English-speaking world. And yet what's interesting is, in physical terms, the Americans are not in the play. But our presence is profoundly in the play. And this, what you're talking, in my own changed dramatic way, the sort of excitement and terror of, how do we do this? Are we really doing this without telling the Americans? Are we really doing this? And so it was a real pleasure to sort of, especially with Bart and the staging, and how to create the sense, also for an American audience to, again, this is the sort of thing you realize after you've made something. Oh, it's very interesting to tell a story in the United States for an American audience to see how the world works when the lens is not the one that we look through.
Yeah, and I think it's absolutely critical that for an American audience or a Western audience to watch and evaluate this thing, it makes it easier for them to participate without feeling a responsibility for their own place in it. So in other words, they watch it from the point of view of the Norwegians, they can give themselves license for some level of objectivity and not opinion or not position or what have you. So we have a very complex, searing conversation between Palestinians and Israelis in New York City, and the vehicle of theater and the comfort of time and history allows a complex conversation to take place.
I mean, going that what I was saying earlier about the difference between theater and journalism, we were excited but nervous and quite thrilled by the first audience response to see what I'm going to say to you is, again, unlike what you could do in a historical or journalistic conclave or panel discussion, in this play and my attempt to put everyone's humanity complexly on stage, in a 1,000-seat theater in the middle of New York City, you have an Israeli man stand up in front of a Palestinian and list the most heart-rending, rageful grievances against the Palestinian people. And in turn, a Palestinian looks at the Israeli and renders forth the most painful and raw and rage feelings of Palestinians. And then they say, and now how do we go forward?
Yeah.
And that to me is
And what theater powerful. Can do is allow that conversation to take place for us to all remember those feelings on both sides and then move to whatever the next conversation would be. So it becomes, and it's actually pretty fun because they also sit and get drunk and tell crazy stories and very off-color jokes and weird other things that happen at the same time. And you see them in a human context, which is provided by theater. So Adam, we have questions. If people have questions, we'd love to try to answer them.
Yeah, let's go to questions. That's great.
Thank you. Edith Lederer from the Associated Press. This time of Oslo was obviously a time of great hope. And all these years later, we are at a great impasse in the Middle East peace process. And I wonder if you've thought about what you would like your audiences, and this goes for Mr. Larsen as well, to take away from this to actually try to move forward to regain the hope that Oslo had?
Maybe I could start. Let me talk a little bit about, Edith, on the basis of your question, about the substance of it. Oslo was the first time that the PLO at the highest level and the State of Israel at the highest level sat down at the same table, symbolized by the handshake between Yitzhak Rabin and Yasser Arafat on the lawn of the White House. And it started a process which went on in earnest, at least as long as Yitzhak Rabin lived, and also a bit beyond. And with the establishment of the Palestinian Authority, the cabinet, their quote-unquote parliament, the ministries, etc., and the kind of self-rule which they have in parts of the West Bank and had in Gaza. Beyond that, the day of the signing of the Oslo Accords, the peace talks between Jordan and Israel started, and at phenomenal speed ended in the full peace agreement between Jordan and Israel, which stands today. And on the basis of that peace agreement between Jordan and Israel, also the Israelis, when Ehud Barak was prime minister of Israel, decided to end their occupation of southern Lebanon, which led to the Israeli withdrawal and the Security Council confirming that Israel had ended its occupation of southern Lebanon, which then led, 4 years later, for Bashar al-Assad to pull out his 45,000 troops from Lebanon because he couldn't justify having 45,000 troops in Lebanon when the Israelis had left, confirmed by the Security Council. I was, as you know, it is lucky to be the negotiator on both these negotiations, and without Oslo, it could not have happened. So Oslo had a regional effect way, way beyond the Palestinian-Israeli negotiations. Then back to your core question, I think the hope which is projected so forcefully in the play, the most important message there is that the impossible is possible. And today, of course, the Middle East is anarchy and chaos. And what I think the play portrays is that even in the darkest of hours, there is a possibility of finding solution if you have an eye for where the window of opportunity is, if you have an eye for how to exploit that opportunity, and if you have the willpower to move. And I think all of that is there now, but it requires leadership and imagination.
And we're theater people, so we are when we set out to do this, the point wasn't to to do anything more than tell a story in which a certain event happened, so that audiences, we don't actually, contrary to popular opinion, we don't come to conclusions. Good theater artists pose better questions. They don't come to real conclusions. So we want to describe the situation with as much depth and accuracy as possible. So it allows a conversation to restart and allows people imaginatively to go back to a place and remember how these conversations took place without our opinion of those things, without our saying we're on this side or that side, because it's essentially like a Shakespearean history play. And we tell a history play and we recount the history, and audiences come in, are amazingly gripped. It's part of their own history. And recall or learn about something they didn't know, and then see where they are within that context. And I think it informs the way in which they look at the conflict now. And I do think if we were to say we believe in any part of it, it's that there is an actual hope for, and a proven hope, that agreements can come in very complex circumstances.
Thank you. My name is Masood Haider. I represent Daily Dawn newspaper of Pakistan. For me, these are all platitudes, because in the aftermath of the Oslo Accord, Professor Advait Said of the Columbia University said that this is an instrument of peace. This instrument is an instrument of surrender for the Palestinians. They gave away 78% of their territory for 22%, and they got nothing. To this day, tell me to this day, nothing has happened. Yes, I mean, we can talk about the process, the peace process, and everything else, but is there any hope that is left? Because you are saying that this is about the process and the peace process. It's been 2 decades, nothing has happened. So how do you tell the Palestinians that there is still hope? That is my question.
We have that to you.
I think I already answered the question by describing the implications of the agreement for the region, for Jordan, for Syria, for Lebanon. And it is actually a fact that you have something called the Palestinian Authority, which has civilian self-rule over the vast majority of the West Bank. They're running their own education system, their own health system, and the military occupation is over. I mean, living conditions are incomparably better, but of course you're right, there is no final end of conflict agreement, and it is still pending. But if you compare the situation today as it was before 1993, I mean, the PLO was in exile, Fatah, and the PLO was branded as a terrorist organization by Washington, by Jerusalem. They have absolutely no influence. And after the collapse of the Soviet Union and Arafat's misjudged alliance with Saddam Hussein in the first Iraqi war, brought the organization to basically bankruptcy. And the PLO will not have existed today, neither Fatah, if you hadn't done the Oslo agreement, because that created a new political foundation for them. And this was, I mean, this was not nothing which was imposed on the Palestinians. It was their own decision. And I will tell you, in the first meeting in Oslo in January, we had, this was the first time the Palestinians and the Israelis sat with each other, very nervous. And we sat chatting together, and then I said, okay, there is here is the room. It was in front of a fireplace in this manor in outside Oslo. So I said, here is the room where you have to negotiate. And I didn't go into the room, so they turned to me and said, are you coming? So I said, no, I will not be with you. I said, but you are supposed to be with us, to guide us. So I said, no, it's your problem. You have to solve it yourselves. I don't want to be in this room. Because, I mean, any solution had to be produced by them and not by us. So this was not a solution which was imposed on them. It was negotiated and agreed by the full leadership of the Palestinians and the Israelis. It was their agreement. It was not something which was imposed on them at all.
Thank you. Yes, right here, please.
Thank you very much. It's kind of a follow-up question. Where do you see the windows of hope that you just mentioned now?
I do believe, again to go into substance, that an agreement which was made bilaterally, and I emphasize bilaterally between the Palestinians and the Israelis, I do not believe it's possible today. If you look at the situation by the parties, I think on the Palestinian side, it is very difficult for the leadership, for Abu Mazen, the president, today to make a compromise with Israel, particularly given the settlement policies. So I think they are politically boxed in. It's extremely difficult to do it. And on the other hand, with the coalition which you have in the Israeli cabinet today, I think also whatever the will of the prime minister must be, he's completely boxed in and his wings are clipped for making a compromise. So my conclusion is basically, today it's probably impossible to make a bilateral agreement between the parties. But I do believe that if you broaden talks and you bring in the broader region, there is a possibility. Because the key Sunni Arab countries, in particular Saudi Arabia and their neighbors, I mean, they are holding cards which are very valuable for both Israel and the Palestinians. So I think if you you have to bring in these and other players into the equation if successful talks can be had today. And here, I actually, it's a paradox since I kind of represent Oslo, but I think the formula from Madrid could be one which could be revived today. Because in a Madrid conference, you didn't only have Palestinian and Israeli representatives, you had representatives in the same room with the Israelis from basically the whole Arab world, including Saudis, Emiratis, Kuwaitis, etc., together with the key Western countries. So I think you have to broaden the equation significantly today, and basically going back to that formula, and I think this is a way to move forward. But this will require leadership and imagination and courage. And I'm not sure if I see that leadership, that courage, and that imagination in the political equation today.
But you might see it at the play.
So go and see it.
Yeah.
Very good. George, yes.
Thank you. George Baumgarten, UN correspondent for Jewish newspapers in North America. I got that lovely note from JT on Friday, for which I thank you, in which you say you're tinkering, but you had a very good first preview. What sort of tinkering are you doing, both dramatically, and is there any other tinkering? Are you any? You told me you eliminated all of the songs. Any thought of any incidental background music or any changes in costumes or sets or anything like that?
Yeah, we abandoned the dance number because it just wasn't going to work out. So, typically at this stage of development, developing a play like this, you know, you start with an idea, and we did three long workshops. And the first one, the play was 4 hours long, and then it was 3.5 hours, you know, four, and then down to three, and then to a place where we thought we could produce it, and then go into a. So we're constantly shaping it. We had 3 weeks of rehearsal to basically remount it, to get it back into the position we had it. We had done cuts from the last version because we felt like it's still 10 minutes perhaps too long. Although it's a very strange piece of theater because no matter how much we cut it, it doesn't get any shorter. So it's I've never had anything like that happen, so it's pretty determined. So it really is now a shaping process. There are two things. One is tightening it and adapting it to what is now a much larger space. So we went from a 300-seat theater downstairs to an 1,100-seat theater upstairs. So everything is essentially two or three times the size, the scale of performance, the reach of the video, everything is larger. So I have a lot of really wonky things I have to do, which is not just get the performances where they should and get it, you know, cut it and maybe make it shorter, but also sort of replace it in a larger context. The context of the Beaumont compared to the Mitzi Newhouse, these two theaters at Lincoln Center, it's actually better in the larger space than in the smaller space. The scale of the event, the scale of the experience is much better suited to the size of the story. So that part has been great.
Thank you. We take one more. We have one more question in the back, and we need to do some. Yeah.
I just had a question about both JT and Taya. You had mentioned that these people were also kind of living together, eating together, drinking together, as Bart said. What is the importance of those like personal relationships, both from a piece perspective and moving that path forward, and then obviously JT, for you, from a play perspective and kind of being able to dramatize that in this way?
Well, I'll go first because yours is real life and has even more, you know, gravitas. Since you were there.
No, I think, I mean, your question goes to, was it me or Bart you wanted to speak?
No,
So I think, actually, that goes to the heart of the matter, because I believe that the organizational model which we used in Oslo produced the agreement, in contradiction to what happened in Washington, where I think the kind of organizational model which they organized there was counterproductive to reaching a result. And the basis of it is that and I touched upon it a little bit before, is that trust and confidence is nothing you can establish between abstract institutions. It's a person-to-person thing. So, and in order to create that trust and that belief that the other guy is in good faith, you have to sit and establish personal relationships. So this is why we insist that it should be small groups and that they should live together. And what we were always present outside the negotiating room for the breakfast, the lunches, the dinners, and the drinks afterwards. So what we always tried to do was to direct the conversation away from the substantive issues and into the personal issues. So they talked about their life, their children, their family, their friends, etc. So that what we actually did was building friendships across the dividing lines. And these friendships between the personalities were there, stay until today. And we actually brought in the families for some of the events, their spouses and kids, etc. So they also became familiar with each other and became friends. So this kind of personality element was at the heart of what we did.
I mean, that's, and what that I learned very early on, and right there was the architecture to a story, following a group of people from being strangers, from enemies to friends and loved ones. And that itself is theater.
I think that we're just about out of time, and I think that actually that last exchange is actually the perfect way to wrap up, because it is sort of a reflection on the peace process as theater and the theater as peace process, and it's a wonderful sort of encapsulation of the whole endeavor. So I just want to say thank you to everyone here and encourage you to see the play if you have not. It's really a fantastic piece of work, so thank you very much.